So this talk is about livestock modeling. I should emphasize up front that I'm actually not a purebred livestock scientist. However, as a farming systems researcher, I use livestock models to understand the role that livestock play in farming systems. So this first slide is to remind ourselves about the importance of livestock systems in the agricultural sector globally. So this map of livestock systems shows us not only, shows us the importance in terms of coverage, but livestock are also a notorious user of natural resources. Water is a particular example there. Livestock systems are also held responsible for a large share of the greenhouse gas emissions from agriculture. And of course, we know that also there is an increasing demand for livestock products that has been so over the past couple of decades and is also projected to continue in the future. So it is indeed important to take livestock into account in our analyses. And how will climate change impact livestock systems? Well, I try to simplify that in this cartoon here. In livestock systems, we will have the impact on crop production, so in terms of biomass production, but also crop suitability and cropping patterns. There will be an impact of climate change on the biomass production of rangelands and pastures, but not only the production, but also the species composition and the herbage quality will change. And so these will have their impact on the animal component then. And so these are actually the indirect effects of climate change through the impacts on the feed availability and the feed quality. Then we also have a direct impact of climate change through the effects of increased temperatures and heat stress on the animals. And so all that will have its impact on feed intake, on growth, on milk production, etc. And then there's a few other important elements that I've indicated here with dashed arrows. And I use these dashed arrows because these are elements that we have not yet taken into account in our models. So it's about impact on water resources, impacts of pests and diseases, etc. Then we also have the likely effect of system shifts of climate change. So especially in regions where the growing season will become shorter, livestock might become more and more important. And then a final element which is important to keep in mind is that extreme events will also have a very different impact on livestock as compared to crops, because for example droughts, they will result in the wiping out of entire herds, and it typically takes years before those herds are built up again. So notwithstanding the importance of livestock systems for agriculture globally and also the importance of climate change on these systems, we actually know very little, and there's actually been very limited attention in the global research community on the effects of climate change on livestock. I've actually stolen these pictures from Mark Howden, but they very nicely illustrate the discrepancy between crops and livestock in the various IPCC chapters. So this one is on the chapter on food security. The picture is less clear perhaps for the regional chapters, but I think in general these graphics, they show us that livestock scientists have a lot of catching up to do with the crop modelers to come to that same level. Okay, a little bit more then about how we used livestock modeling in our regional assessment in Southern Africa within the AgMIP project. So this is the modeling framework we used. And so you see here that we use climate data as an input to crop models. The outputs from the crop model are used in a livestock model, and then the outputs from the crop and the livestock model are used as an input to the economic model. Now, as this talk is about livestock modeling, I've put livestock here in the middle of the graph, and with all the arrows, I try to illustrate the linkages with the other components of the system and the type of input that we need to run our livestock model. So a couple of things to note. First of all, that there's actually a dashed arrow here from climate to livestock, and that is because we're not yet taking into account the direct effects of temperature changes on animal productivity. Secondly, to have an idea about the availability of biomass from the grazing lands, we need information not only, of course, on productivity of these rangelands, but also on the area of these rangelands and the stocking density. And that's in particular quite tricky for African systems, where rangelands are common property and managed by communities. We have very little privately owned pastures, and that, of course, complicates the quality of the information we can get on that. There's an obvious link from the crop models to the livestock model, because we need information on feed, so crop residues, forages, etc. And then we need a lot of household information, because as livestock modelers, we're not interested in crop yields. We want to know what the fodder availability is at the farm level. So we want to know fodder production. So we need information on the field sizes to be able to calculate that. Then we need information on the herd size and the composition, and also of the livestock management of these different households. The LIFSIM model then, very briefly, so this is the model we've used in this regional assessment. The model is based on the principles of production ecology. That means that it starts by calculating the potential production based on the genetic potential of the breed, and then that potential production is reduced by taking into account the limiting factors such as feed availability and feed quality. LIFSIM uses a monthly time step. It simulates individual animals in a herd and also simulates herd dynamics. We look at the traditional outputs such as milk, number of calves, body weight, manure production, and we're also adding greenhouse gas emissions as an output to the model. So that is being implemented as we speak, actually. And then I wanted to show you a quick example just to make it all a bit more concrete. So this example draws from our analysis in Zimbabwe again. Here I just took the data that we have for 10 households within our database. You see that not everyone in that sample keeps cattle. You see also that actually the land size, the farm size, varies from about half a hectare to about 5 or 6 hectares. And here we're focusing on maize, as this is the most important crop in these systems currently. You see that the maize stover yields, they vary across the years, and they also vary between two different soil types that are important in this area. With climate change, you see that we predict a slight decrease in those stover yields. So that's important to take into account. And then, as I said, we're not interested so much in the yields, but rather we're interested in farm-level fodder availability. And so this is then how these yields are translated to whole farm fodder availability for the households that have cattle, actually, in this sample. That is on-farm fodder availability. This is then off-farm fodder availability from the rangelands. So here you see the average energy availability from that rangeland for the 12 months in the year. And you see also that here in the dry period, there is a bit of a feed gap. And it's especially in this dry period that farmers use the maize crop residues to supplement their cattle. So this is really the input that we need to run our model: information on number of animals, information on land sizes, information on yields, and information on rangeland fodder availability. Then a quick look at the type of outputs we can generate. So this is monthly milk production for one cow, the body weight of that cow over the months. Of course, we're not interested in just one cow, but in the entire herd of a farm. And this is then the summary annual milk production over 30 years of the simulation. But we're not interested just in one household. We're interested in all the households of our database. So here you see how the milk production can change between households. And that's related to the number of animals that these people keep and their farm sizes. And then this is just a quick comparison of three different scenarios. So you see that from the current to the future climate, typically there is a decrease in milk production. And most of these households, they actually manage to produce slightly more milk if they adopt an improvement package. And then a final slide, just to conclude on a few of our challenges. I think from the graphs that I showed on the IPCC comparison with crops, I think you realize that livestock modeling still has a lot of catching up to do. And also within ECMIP, we've actually not yet come to a model comparison or even a proper sensitivity analysis of the livestock models that are available. We've not yet included the direct effects of temperature, but well, you could say the same about taking into account other important effects, such as effects of water availability. I think what is a bigger problem is the uncertainty we have in terms of the estimates of feed availability, especially for the extensive systems in Africa, where the pastures are commonly managed and not privately owned. This is related to the data availability for model calibration, setup, and input data. We've realized that, especially in the African context, data on livestock systems is even harder to come by as compared to data on cropping systems. And then finally, we've noticed that there's also weak modeling capabilities in the region. We've been very lucky to identify excellent livestock experts to join the teams in the regions, but we also found out that the modeling capacity of these people is actually really limited. So there's really a lot of capacity building to do in that respect. That's it, thank you. Okay, thanks very much.